So we do since many years joint project with Daimler, and it was about a year ago where Wilfried said, are you interested in quantum computing? I said, why should I be interested in quantum computing? I'm a mathematician, astrophysicist by education. I said, that's interesting, but this is something that is ready in the next 100 years. And he told me, no, it's nearly ready in the next few years, and we Daimler are very interested in it, and Wilfried will let you know why Daimler is interested or the industry is interested in it. And then we are digging deeper now into quantum computing, and I even give a lecture in the winter term about quantum computing. So what the hell is it? So I only want to introduce you a little bit of physics for 10 minutes, 20 minutes mathematics, and then 30 minutes about some underpinnings of quantum computing, right? Some the computer science.
Where's the application?
Not at all.
No.
Wilfried will tell you the application.
I
see. Yeah? How quantum computing will save the world.
Yeah?
Not blockchain. It's quantum computing. So, a little bit of quantum physics. The first thing that you need to understand is something that's called the photoelectric effect. The photoelectric effect is you shine light on the surface of material, and at the sudden you see electrons coming out of the material. And in contrast to traditional physics, this happens even if you only have a very low intensity of the light. So the electrons, and the classical theory says, no, you must shine light on the material for minutes or even hours, if you're that, and then some electrons collected enough energy to come out of the material. Right? So this was a surprise to Planck and others. And what was then measured is the dislodgement. Dislodgement of electrons only depends on the frequency of the incoming light. Yeah? The higher the frequency is, the faster are the electrons getting out. And this energy is always an integer multitude of h times nu. H is a constant, the Planck constant. So Einstein then had a hypothesis saying light itself is made of individual packets of quanta, which we call photons today. And the energy is h times nu, where nu is the frequency of the light, and this is a very famous formula, E equals h times nu. Right? This is how you can compute the energy. Then there was a couple of years later a different experiment. You shine light into electron gases, for example, and then what you see is that an electron that got beaten by a light beam gets a detour. And this can only be explained if you say that light is exchanging momentum by the fact that photons have a mass, because only massive particles can result in the detour of another particle. This was a shock. Light is a mass. And then Einstein said, okay, I discovered a few years ago a very famous formula, E equals n times c squared from relativity theory. You combine it, that E equals h times nu, and then you get an easy formula for the mass of a light beam, of a light, of a photon, right, of this kind of quantum. Very easy. So then the observation is, if you have a beam of light, and the same beam of light can first go to a mirror, it gets reflected, and you can explain that because light is a wave. And then you do another experiment, like the Compton experiment I said before, and then the same beam of light passes momentum to another particle. That means the beam of light is both. It's a wave as well as matter. We call this wave particle duality, right? It's really both. So, and so if light is sometimes a wave and sometimes a particle, the question was, can normal matter be considered as a wave? Am I a wave? Because there's am I a wave? And so if I have a certain mass, too much, right, then we can compute the wavelength of me being a wave. It's very easy. Can you prove that? Yes, you can have another experiment. Right, you send an electron beam through a metal plate that has a little hole there, and then you see really, according to classical wave physics, optics, how the electron gets scattered behind the hole. Absolutely. So every matter is also a wave. And even you are waves. You can even measure if you walk through a door that you get a little bit stretched. Right? It's only that's a little bit a fraction of an atom, but you can stretch, you can measure it. Very interesting. Then another interesting thing came up. It was called Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. It basically says if you have a piece of matter, an electron, flying around and you want to measure the speed of the electron at a particular location. X is the location, the speed, that means the momentum is P, right? You can't measure location and speed with the same precision, right? So the uncertainty, in German Unschärfe, so the uncertainty of the location times the uncertainty of P is always greater than this constant. Right? That means if you want to know exactly where the electron is, right, you have no clue at all what the speed is. And if you want to measure the speed, you don't know at which location you measure this kind of speed. It's the uncertainty principle. So it's fundamentally not possible to determine the position and the momentum of a particle at the same time. And measuring the momentum of a particle, so the moment when you measure the electron is now at this position, at the sudden this uncertainty gets infinite. Right? So if you know the exact position, you measure the position, right, then the other state, the speed, gets infinitely uncertain. Right? And this is the underpinning of what we will call superposition. Right? Superposition is something that you learn later. Right? If you want to measure the state of a bit, right, of a state in a quantum computer, as soon as you measure it, you destroy it. So you can read data in a quantum computer only once, which is interesting for my database friends. Right? You read only once. So what is this state? The actual state of a system or an electron or a beam of light, that means the speed, momentum, location, is a mathematical object. So you have, if you are interested in different kinds of state information, here in this case, location, momentum, energy, for example, it's a vector in this three-dimensional space, if you are interested in three different states, right? And, okay, it's a it's a complex vector space, right? Complex has to do with complex numbers, if you remember that they measure how waves are basically moving on, right? So it's a complex space. And it's a special kind of space that I'm going to introduce as a Hilbert space. It's a special kind of a vector space, right? Now the superposition that I said before is the following. The overall state of the system, the overall state of the system here, right? It's a superposition of the states you're interested in. So in mathematics, you know that because as computer scientists, you had to take some linear algebra, right? Quantum physics is all about linear algebra, the difference of partial differential equation. So it's a linear combination of the different states, and the CIs, the factors, are complex numbers. So easy. And the states are orthogonal to each other. So you measure velocity in this thing and energy in this direction. You can basically define what an orthonormal basis is. I will come back what that means. And the interesting thing of these factors is that the square of the modulus is giving the probability you measure a particular state. So if you want to measure the state phi I, if this is the velocity of the particle, then C I gives the probability that you measure this kind of state. Right? And when you measure, you always measure something. That means the sum of the squared moduli equals to 1. Right? This basically says, okay, the probability is 1 that we will be able to measure something. And this is very famous. Some people like it, some people hate it. This is Schrödinger's cat. Superposition can be explained with this very cruel experiment. So cats are famous, right? Where's Stefan? Stefan has the cats, I also have cats here. You have a cat and put it into a box, and in the box you have a very cruel mechanism. You have poison, right? You have radioactive material, and there's a sensor that determines whether the radioactive material is decaying. And if you measure a decay, the sensor will basically act on an actuator, and the actuator releases the hammer, and the hammer crashes on the poison, and the poison is poison gas, and the cat will die. Wow, brutal. Right, so you close the door, you close the box, and then you wait for some time. And then the question is the cat alive, or is the cat dead? Yeah, you really don't know, right, because in the meantime, a decay might have happened, and already the poison would have killed the cat. But if not the decay, if the decay did not happen, then the cat is still alive. It's a superposition. It's a zombie. It's a superposition of being dead and alive. And you don't know that. In a random you don't know that. You need to open the box, and this means you to destroy the superposition, and then you know, oh, the cat is dead or the cat is alive. So measuring means open the box, and then you destroy the superposition of being a zombie, right? And then you are dead, not you. And then the cat is dead or alive, right? This is inner. So measuring delivers the result, it destroys superposition. So, and then the whole mathematical theory has been created. It's called quantum mechanics. Quantum mechanics is not an experimental part of stuff. It's a system of axioms that people like John von Neumann created in order with these kinds of phenomena, right? So it's not observed from nature, but they came up with an axiom system in order to build mathematics to reason about quantum physics. And one of the axioms, postulates or axioms, is every isolated physical system is associated with the Hilbert space over C, the so-called state space. I mean, if I observe something, it's a state space and it's a complex vector space. So we need to understand what complex vector spaces are. And this is not the most difficult thing. There's an operator on this vector space, right? They call it the Hamiltonian, a Hamilton operator, or Hamiltonian for brief, that describes how a quantum system evolves over time. So it's a function over time. And this is a very famous equation called the Schrödinger equation. It describes how the system evolves, and you need to find a solution, the Hamilton operator, that if you have that, then you know how the system does evolve. And the quantum physicists spend 80% of their time to try to find with their brain a quantum operator that describes systems under observation. Next thing is you have another operator. This is called an observable. An observable is I open a box. Right? It's an operator that opens the box that destroys superposition in order to make now an observation. And nobody understands why, but everything that you observe is what we call an eigenvalue of the operator. So this is absolutely, nobody knows why. You measure physical systems by a special kind of an operator. The operator has the property of being Hermitian. I will discuss it, what it basically is. And the observable values are always eigenvalues. I remind you what an eigenvalue is, of this kind of an operator. And again, you can't ask me why it is. Nobody understands why it is. Nature is this way. They only allow us to measure eigenvalues. Very strange. And very important, how do you do measurement? There is a spectral, a theorem called the spectral theorem in mathematics. I will discuss that. If you observe a certain value, lambda is an eigenvalue, the system transitions into a new state. It's a vector in what we call an eigenspace. An eigenvalue is associated with an eigenspace, right? And if you observe a certain eigenvalue, if you measure it, the system remains in the eigenvector, the eigenspace of the eigenvalue. Nobody knows why. It's just nature. So philosophers are discussing since decades, why the hell is nature this way? And the state space of a composed system is a tensor product of state spaces of the components. So if you have two different electrons and you want to understand what the two different electrons are doing, right, then you need to create the tensor product of the different states. So you don't need to understand it, right? So we need some math, we need Hilbert spaces, Hermitian operators, unitary, blah, 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 blah. And I briefly run over it. So I don't expect that you do understand it, but you will get the slides. And on Friday we will have the exam.
Yeah.
So, that's good. You will be out. Yeah. So, vector space.
So I did it really. Roughly 2 years at university.
Okay.
Any kind of experience about that one?
Okay. So I only remind you. I assume because you had mathematics in the first semester or second semester, it's only a brief to refresh your memory. So vector space. Here is an example of a vector space. You have a field, typically the real numbers or the complex numbers, but you can use any kind of field. Well, it's an n-tuple, these are the values, right? And then you can, this is a vector, or a representation of a vector, you can add it component-wise. You have a scalar, that means a real number or a complex number. You can multiply a vector with a number, and then you get another vector. This is what you all know, I assume, right? Typically, at my age, you got that in Unter Prima, right? One year before you get your admission to university. And then we already mentioned what is the linear combination. You have vectors vi and numbers ai. And if you build this kind of sum, right, and you can create the zero vector, right, then the vectors v1 to vn are called linear independent, right? If you can combine the vectors into the zero vectors, if and only if all the numbers are zero. Here are two independent numbers, right? You cannot multiply this vector and add it and get the zero vector. You just can't do it, it's linear independent. While in contrast, these two vectors are linear dependent, right? You can stretch this vector and then multiply it with minus one, and then you take the sum and then it's zero. Right, so this is, I assume that you remember it now, linear independent, linear dependent. Based on dependency of vectors, you define what a basis is. So a basis of a vector space is a set of vectors, v1 to vn. They are linear independent. And the set of all linear combinations of the vectors is the whole vector space. So each vector is a linear combination of this basis vectors. Right, there's a very important theorem, all bases on the vector space have the same number of vectors, right? This is why you can speak about the dimension of a vector space as the number of basis vectors that you need in order to span the whole vector space. In quantum physics, you often deal with infinite dimensional vector spaces, right? I will not bore you with infinite dimensional vector spaces, right? These are all solutions of differential equations, typically. Right, so, but for the sake of the presentation, finite dimensional vector spaces are fine. Here's an example. You all know this. These are the standard bases. You always have a 1 in each component. This would be an n-dimensional vector space spanned by this basis vectors. Then we need the notion of what a linear map is. It's a map between vector spaces. And why is the map called a linear map? Yeah, because it preserves linearity. Right? If you take the image of A times X, is A times the image of X, and if you take the image of the sum of two vectors, is the sum of the image of the two vectors. It's a linear map. And each linear map, also it's a reminder, can be turned into a matrix. All you need to do is use the linear map, you determine the basis of the vector space, and then you take the images of each basis vector, you write them as columns, one column beside the other, it's a matrix, and this is then the matrix of the linear map. And with matrices, you can easily compute stuff, right? So matrices are a proper basis for to do some computations. Now come the eigenvalues, so eigenwert in German, this is like kindergarten, right? We speak about eigenvalues. An eigenvalue, lambda, it's a non-zero value, it's got an eigenvalue, if you find a vector in the vector space, so that the image of the vector is only a multiple of the vector itself. Right? So in this direction, the map is only a stretching map or is shrinking something. Right? So like, yeah, this is easy. And the vector v that you find is an eigenvector. So in the direction of an eigenvector, f is stretching or shrinking something. And you can easily prove if you find a vector, then the multiple. If you find an eigenvector, then the multiples of the vector is also an eigenvector, blah, blah, blah. So what it ends up with, the eigenvectors associated with the eigenvalue is an eigenspace. It's a sub-vector space. So, and nobody knows why measuring means observing eigenvalues. Again, nobody does understand it. It's just how nature has been built by whoever you believe in. Yeah, so this is it. Here's an example. If you have a map F that is a reflection, Spiegelung, right? Here we reflect on the axis that is spanned by V1, right? Then the eigenvalue is it's 1 because this vector, right? The axis on which you reflect, right, is preserved by the reflection. And here the eigenvalue of F2 is -1 because it does reflect. So it's a two-dimensional vector space, a map in the two-dimensional vector, you have two eigenvalues. We have another map. It's called a shear, right? You basically shear a vector F to vector V to F of V, and it's not an eigenvector because it's not a multiple of V. So what we see here is, this is a map that has only a single eigenvalue, right? A single eigen. It's only have one eigenvalue and not two. And here, if you have a rotation, nothing is a stretch, right? If you rotate by angles different than 0 and 360 degrees, you have no eigenvalue. So if you have a map, it's a problem to determine the eigenvalues, right? And even the number of eigenvalues. And the set of eigenvalues is called a spectrum. It has a reason why it's spectrum, right? Because eigenvalues are important. If you take the Bohr atomic model, right, what kind of light can be emitted, what is the frequency, and only, and then you measure eigenvalues, and these are then the wavelengths that can be emitted by atoms. So this is called the spectrum. The set of eigenvalues is called the spectrum of a linear map. And a complex vector space, all in a complex vector space, right, then each map of a complex vector space has at least one eigenvalue. In real vector spaces, this doesn't happen. This is also another fortune, right? If nature would behave that way, that we are living in a real vector space, some measurement would not return any value. But it turns out that the quantum world is a complex vector space, and every map in a complex vector space always has at least one eigenvalue, so we can measure results in this kind of experiments. Right? Again, philosophy, nobody knows why. And determining eigenvectors is, well, if you determine an eigenvalue, then you need to solve a linear equation here, and then you get easily all the eigenvectors. Easy means if you remember what you've done 6 weeks after beginning to study mathematics. And measuring transform the system into an eigenvector. You start with the overall system, you measure, and what remains is a state that lives in a smaller subspace, the eigenspace. Now, Hilbert spaces. What the hell is a Hilbert space? I assume that you still know what a scalar product is. Very easy. These are the axioms. You don't need to read it. Here's the most famous example. If you have two vectors, all you do is you multiply the components of the vectors and then you sum it up. Forget why you have this bar here. This is not interesting for the sake of this presentation. Right? And each vector space, if the vector space is a scalar product, it's called a pre-Hilbert space. Right? For the sake of this presentation, we call it a Hilbert space, because you need to distinguish between pre-Hilbert spaces and Hilbert spaces only in the case of infinite dimensional vector spaces. There is another axiom, completeness, that each Cauchy series is converging. You remember what Cauchy series are, what convergence mean, yeah? So, but in finite dimensionality, pre-Hilbert space and Hilbert space is the same terminology. So, And if you have a scalar product, there is a norm. A norm allows you to measure length. You need to measure length, right? A norm is a function of that associates each vector a non-negative number, right? And the number you associate with the vector is zero if and only if it is zero vector. If you multiply a vector by a number lambda, then you multiply the length of the vector with lambda. And this is the triangle inequality. If you have two vectors, sum of two vectors, and the length of the sum of the two vectors is less than or equal to the sum of the lengths. This is then called a norm. And luckily, every Hilbert space, that means this vector space that has a scalar product, is a norm vector space because the length measurement is the square root of x times x. This is Pythagoras, right? So this is ground school. Pythagoras. And you learned at ground school that each Hilbert space. So now we know what lengths are, we know what the scalar product is, and at the sudden we can define what the angle between two vectors are. Right? Because this is a formula, we need to accept it, you can prove it, the arcus cosinus of the product of the vector v with the vector w divided by their length gives you the angle between the two different vectors. And we call two vectors orthogonal if their product is zero, right? Because then if the product is zero, arcus cosinus of zero is pi and a half, yeah? So, and what turns out is if you have two eigenvectors, eigenvalues, remember the eigenvalues, the eigenspaces of two different eigenvalues are always orthogonal. Yeah. So if you have a map that is stretching in this direction and this direction, this can only happen if both directions are orthogonal to each other. Right? This is the, and then if you, then we need the notion of orthogonal projection. It means you have a three-dimensional space. Here is an eigenspace, and an orthogonal projection means you have the vector v and you project it. You can imagine like a light v. Right? You have a light. And what you see then here is the orthogonal projection. Right? And orthogonal projection is because nature means measuring means always taking orthogonal projections onto some eigenspaces. Right? Then there is a, we said that measurement always happens with Hermitian maps. And the Hermitian map is a map that the scalar product of the image of vector u with v is the same as u multiplied by f of v. So you can exchange, you can switch the f between here. And the importance of a Hermitian map is, if you have a Hermitian operator, a Hermitian map, then the values, the eigenvalues, are all real numbers. And this is, and again, measuring means to have a Hermitian operator. Nature is crazy. Measuring always is a Hermitian operator. As an Hermitian operator, has eigenvalues that are real, although they are living in a complex vector space, and this is fantastic. This is why we only measure real numbers, and not these damned complex numbers that nobody really does understand. Right? So nature is so crazy that measuring always a Hermitian operator, and in mathematics Hermitian operator have real eigenvalues. This is why we always say the temperature is not x plus I times y, it's always x. Yeah? And if you have a Hermitian operator, then this is the spectral theorem. That means these kind of operators, linear maps, are very, very simple. They are orthogonal projections on the eigenspaces of the eigenvalues of the Hermitian map. This is why measuring is always projecting onto eigenspaces. Because an Hermitian, you can pick any Hermitian operator to measure a physical system. This Hermitian operator has always this representation, and measuring always means orthogonal projection on some eigenspace of the value that you basically measured. Again, you don't need to understand it completely, you only to hear the terms again. And this basically means that any Hermitian map, here is the original shape that you have. If you apply the linear map, one dimension and shrinking the other dimension. So because the eigen spaces are all orthogonal to each other, right? And orthogonal, so your lambda is the eigenvalue, it stretches in this eigenspace and, for example, shrinking in the other eigenspace. Well, they are very simple, this kind of Hermitian maps.
I want to see the animation here.
Oh. Thank you. We discussed it before, but it was happening. So, and now again here, this measurement is projected on the eigenspace, result is the corresponding eigenvalue. Now we need to introduce another thing, unitary operator. A unitary operator is an operator that is angle preserving. Right? So you have two vectors, u and v. We saw before how to define the angle between the two vectors. And if you map the vectors, so f of u and f of v, it's the same angle. So unitary maps are angle preserved. And it's absolutely crazy. Right? A quantum computer can be manipulated only by unitary maps, right? They're angle preserving. Right? So nature is absolutely fantastic. So a corollary is a unitary map is always injective. That means it has an invertible map. And this is absolutely crazy because the quantum algorithm uses unitary computation steps only. That means each step is reversible. Some of you might have heard about reversible computing, right? And classical computing is non-reversible. That means if you manipulate bits in a computer, you are losing energy. A quantum computer, you can run a quantum computer without losing energy because of the computation. Right? Another interesting phenomenon. Right? So, quantum algorithm is a bunch of unitary operations that you apply, and if you want to get the result, you apply a Hermitian operator to observe the result of 1 plus 1 is 2, right? So the computation is unitary, and the measurement is a Hermitian map. So, leaving time. Now, what is a quantum bit, a qubit? It's a very crazy notation. Right? If you observe a system in the state y, then the vector is not called y, it's this crazy notation. It's called the so-called Dirac notation. It's a Nobel Prize laureate because he said, I have a scalar product, I have a left angular brace and a right angular brace, and he basically said, I take this thing and call it the ket vector, and the other is the bra vector. If you want to understand quantum computing, right? You need to understand this crazy thing. Although, as a mathematician, I would also write only write this y. But they use this notation to confuse the Russians. Are Russians here? No, I don't think so. Right? So it's strange. So don't be confused. And then we introduce our quantum bit. The quantum bit is in the two classical states, 0 or 1, that the classical bit is, at the same time. So a bit is only 1 or 0. The quantum bit is both 0 and 1 at the same time. Very precisely, it's in a superposition. Right? We have a complex number alpha. It's in the state alpha times 0 plus beta times 1. Right? That means the traditional computer can be... Oh, I have this as a consequence. Oh, wait a second. Oh, sorry. Sorry. That means a state is always a point on the one-dimensional circle, right? Because, as I said before, superposition always means that alpha square plus beta square equals 1. Alpha square is the probability that you observe 1. Beta square is the probability that you observe 1. So the sum must be 1 because if you measure, you get either 0 or 1. So a quantum computer is manipulating an infinite number of values at the same time because the bit is neither 0 nor 1, it's any kind of superposition, any point on this sphere. It's a fascinating increase of compute power. Right? So, measurement. A classical bit can be read, you can find out exactly the state of a classical bit, is it 0 or 1. A qubit cannot be read because the state is in superposition. And if you measure it, you destroy superposition because based on measuring, you get the result 0 or 1, right? So you can't read data because reading, you cannot find out what the value was that you read. You only read the projection. So qubit can be read only once. Yeah? Interesting for the universe. So, and measuring. ring. So this is a qubit X. It is in this state. And if you read it, right, you read the zero with probability alpha squared. You read one with probability beta squared. And the computation step, right, this is here a qubit. And the computation step is a unitary map. And the unitary map basically preserves length and angles. That means the unitary operation would map this state into this state, for example. And as we said, computation steps are unitary maps in this complex vector space. So any quantum algorithm has this structure. Right? The quantum algorithm basically says you need to prepare the state of the overall system, a bunch of electrons or photons that are prepared. Then you apply a unitary map transformation. For example, you send laser beams into the electrons and then they do interfere. Right? And then you start measuring, then you get the result. So the whole crux in building a quantum computer is how you implement the unitary transformations. We will only deal with them as linear maps, but the quantum physicists, they need to find ways how to represent matrices in real physical objects. Right? And there are many different kinds how you can build a quantum computer, and the different kind of underlying hardware needs different kind of manipulations, right? Here's your first quantum algorithm. We want to build a real random number generator. You know that classically you can only build pseudo random numbers. It's very easy to have a real quantum number. You have a number, you have an algorithm. You want to have an algorithm that results in zero with probability a half, one with the probability a half. So what you do is you initialize the quantum bit by zero, you apply something that we will call in the next couple of minutes an Hadamard operator. It's a unitary map that you use to achieve what we call entanglement. It's another very important term that you will learn today. Entanglement. You entangle the state and you measure it. And what is happening then here is, this is this Hadamard operator. Just forget what that means. So you initialize the qubit to zero. The Hadamard transformation transforms it into this state. Right? This state, and when you measure, you get with probability 1 square root of 2 square 0, 1 square root of 2, you measure 1. That means you have a real quantum generator. And you can buy this kind of hardware. If I understand right, Sharon bought this kind of hardware to generate real quantum numbers. Right? Was it expensive or you don't know?
3-4,000.
Okay. Now we have a quantum bit. What is a quantum register? A quantum register. So register is a quantum register is a series of n qubits, like a classical register is a series of n bits. Right? So it's the very same. But a quantum register with n qubits is a superposition of this corresponding 2^n states. These are the states. I will explain this notation later. It means a classical register with n bits has one way of time. One value at a time. A quantum register has 2^n values at the same time. Right? And the operators manipulate all these values at the same time. This is what we call quantum parallelism. Right? A traditional machine can only manipulate one value at a time in a sequence. A quantum computer, in one shot, can manipulate 2^n bits at the same time. That's an inherent aspect of a quantum computer. Now I'm going to introduce what a quantum register is formally. A register is a product of 2 qubits, and it's really, so assume that x0 is this superposition, x1 is this superposition, and this is a real product called a tensor product. Jesus, very complicated term again. So a tensor product, you have here R, x1 times x0, and now I substitute x1 by this expression, x0 by this expression, right? I multiply it, right? And then there is a convenient notation. You don't need to have these angles here in between. You just write it this way, right? 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1. This is, so to speak, the state of each individual qubit, but it's a superposition. So the alphas here are basically the products of the different factors, right? And this is a mathematical beast that is called the tensor product. If you have 2 vector spaces, V and W, that have the basis V1 to Vn, W1 to Wm, then the tensor product of the vector space is an n times n vector space. Typically, what you learned in linear algebra is if you have two vector spaces, V and W, and they take the Cartesian product, this, you have the sum as the dimension of the two vector spaces. The Cartesian product of two vector spaces has a dimension that is the sum. Here, you have a multiple. Because, and this is nothing that you can understand, as often in mathematics, it's only a symbolic representation. So out of the vector, out of the basis V1, V and W, right, you build the formal expressions V1 tensor W1, V1, and this is the basis of the newly created vector space. Right? Here's an example, you have two vectors, if you build the tensor product, you multiply alpha 1 with beta 1 and beta 2, alpha 2 with beta 1 and beta 2. So that's a four-dimensional thing. And if you have, and the qubits are basically the tensor product. Right? By the way, we call it H2, that is the two-dimensional Hilbert space that represents the single qubit. And if you multiply, and if you have this vector space here, right, and a register with n qubits is this kind of a vector space. It's the tensor space, it's the tensor product of the two-dimensional complex vector space that represents a single qubit. So that means the vector space of an n qubit register has the dimension 2 to the power of n. Yeah? Huge vector space. Parallelism, quantum parallelism. One operator manipulates all this huge number of bits in a single step. So and now we call a state separable. This is a state in this tensor product. It's a quantum register. And the quantum register is separable if it is the tensor product of the individual states of each qubit. Right? If it's not separable, we call it entangled. And this is the most important term at all, because quantum computing is so powerful, first of all, because of you have a quantum parallelism and entanglement. We'll see what entanglement is in the next minute. So here, separable, this is a quantum state in the tensor product. It's the tensor product of the qubits. This is a separable state. And this is, again, a separable thing. So let's take a look at it. If you measure the first qubit, right, you always measure zero. Right? If the result is this thing here, this zero or this zero, you always measure zero with probability a half. 1 to the square root of 2 squared. But once you measured, you didn't change the overall state, because if you measure the first qubit, the system does collapse, and only the second qubit remains. But the second qubit is still in superposition of 0 and 1. This is if you are not entangled. The qubits are independent if you are not entangled. But if you are entangled, if you measure the first qubit as 0, the system collapses to this thing here, and the second qubit is also 0. If you measure the first qubit as 1, the second qubit is also 1. It means there are two qubits that are absolutely entangled. Yeah? And this is something that even Albert Einstein said, this can't happen. This is bullshit. Because what it basically means, this is the very famous Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen paradox, EPR paradox. Although Einstein got his Nobel Prize for quantum physics, right, he was always fighting this bullshit idea. It's not, you know, God is not throwing a dice. Yeah, because throwing a dice means random theory. Yeah?
Probably. Although he didn't call it bullshit, he called it the spooky effect.
Okay, okay. He's right. Charm is right, as always. Yeah? So, and what that basically means is, and that most of the very effective algorithms in quantum computing are, you produce two qubits in entanglement. For example, if the quantum computer is based on electrons, right, you produce them with reverse spin, then you separate it to different locations, and if you measure the spin of this bit, immediately the other one reveals what its value is. This is entanglement. Although the parts of the two qubits are physically apart, measuring one immediately reveals what the measurement is at the other side. Right? All the very effective quantum algorithms are fundamentally based on entanglement. And this Hilbert, this Hadamard matrix that you saw before, this H matrix, this always produces an entanglement state. This is why you typically initialize a quantum register. You apply the Hadamard operator to apply entanglement between the qubits. Then you apply quantum parallelism. Then you measure, and you measure immediately all the values of the other qubits. And we will see some examples. So entanglement is something that's unique to quantum computing. Every computation that is not using entanglement can be emulated on a traditional computer with the same effectiveness. So entanglement is at the heart of the power of quantum computers. So how do you use a quantum computer? So what are the operators? So if you have a single bit, and you have a linear map, a unitary map between the vector space of the single qubit, then we call this a qubit operator, or a gate. There are other quantum computers, not all of, other models, not all gate-based as we are used with traditional computers, but for the sake of this lecture, that's okay. Here are very famous one-bit operator. They are called Pauli matrices. Pauli is a Nobel Prize laureate in chemistry, I think. Here is the negation of a qubit. Here is you flip the phase, you exchange the value of the phases, and so you don't need to understand what the integers are. This is the Hadamard matrix. This is for the phase matrix. This is the pi divided by a matrix. Although you have pi divided by 4, there are some historical reasons. I didn't find them what the historical reasons are. So it's a conflict of name, but nobody cares. So these are very important operators to change a little qubit only, right? So we call a set of one qubit operators universal if every other operator is a finite combination of this hopefully small set of operators. Right? So let u be a one bit operator, then you can prove that the set of Pauli operators are universal for one qubit operator. That means any manipulation of a single qubit is a finite combination of the Pauli matrices, the three Pauli matrices you saw before. Right? Very interesting. Now, can we find a universal set of operators for a quantum register? So we need to make a following step, right? So a unitary map of this quantum register with n qubits is of course called a quantum register operator or a quantum gate. And the set of quantum register operators is universal if any other quantum register operator is a finite combination of this operator. So now we need to find a set of universal operators. How do we do it? We define what is called a two-level operator. A two-level operator only switches two neighborhood qubits. You have a quantum register. Right, and the two-level operator only manipulates two quantum bits in a full register. And what you then can prove is, any quantum operator can be represented as a product of R two-level matrices. So these two-level operators that only manipulate two qubits can be used to produce any kind of manipulation of a quantum register. But here's the estimation what R basically means. So you need a lot of two-level operators to realize a unitary operator. Right? So the set of two-level operators is universal, but you have an infinite number of two-level operators because any map that is manipulated in two dimensions of the vector space, any, is this kind of thing. And this is too much. Yeah? The set of universal operators should be small. So the next attempt is then we introduce the quantum equivalent of negation. It's called a controlled knot. C knot, controlled knot. So you have a two quantum bit register, x and y, and this is the modulo 2 addition operation. That means if x is 0, y remains in the state. If x is 1, 1 plus y is negative. Right? So the controlled knot that is dependent on the first bit, you negate the second bit. If the first bit is 1, the second bit is negated. If the first bit is 0, it remains in its state. And then it turns out, so CNOT is a unitary operator, you can easily compute that. And then there's a very famous theorem. Any operation on the quantum bit is the product of a one qubit operator, the Pauli matrices, and the CNOT operator. Right? Pauli is universal. The Pauli matrices is accepted before. But now again, if you have an n qubit quantum register, right, then you need this kind of operators in order to realize on a machine a unitary operator. And this is much too much. Right? N, you have an n qubit register, right? You need this kind of number of operators. Right? And the real crux is you have to apply many, many operators, but these quantum systems only live for fractions of a second. Really small fractions of a second. That means you can only apply a certain number of operators, and if you're not fast enough, the system already interacted with the environment and crashed. That means we need to look for a smaller set of operators. And this, the bad news is, it can't be found. There's a very famous theorem, Solovyov-Diatel theorem. It basically says you can only approximate unitary operators, but the approximation means the following. The approximation is you can, so if you measure, you measure values with a certain probability. And what this theorem says is you can have a very small number of operators, these operators here, and you can approximate with arbitrary precision the statistics of the original unitary operator. Because you measure everything only based on probability, if you change the probability only a little bit, you don't care. And the quantum computer guys say this is acceptable. But because everything is probabilistic, anyhow, right, if I change the probability only a little bit, I don't care. And this is how all the gate-based quantum computers are basically built. Tools, there are a lot of tools. I took some pictures here by IBM. This is a graphical tool, how to build your operators. Right? And here you see the Hadamard matrix, the Pauli matrices. And what you do is you compose in this graphical tool the different operators. You apply the negation of a quantum bit. Here you measure. Here's a traditional bit. And because everything is statistic, right, the computer gives you the result with 92% probability. The value is now 1. And with 7%, the value was 0. And then you apply the same operation multiple times, because probabilities do multiply. And if you do it 2, 3, 5 times, you get the real result. Right? So it's always iterative, what the quantum computer does. This is another thing. Oh, here is an assembler, so to speak. You can't read it, it's very bad. But it's an assembler language. They call it OpenQuantum, quantum assembler. Right, open quasim that you can use in order to write your programs. Do you want to write assembler programs? No! So this is, but not only IBM has this kind of tools, Microsoft has it, Google has it, and so on. You will get the handouts, and then you can easily go to the pages and fiddle around with it. Now, the algorithm of Deutsch. It's not German, the man David Deutsch, right? So there's the following problem. You have a coin, and you want to find out whether the coin is a real coin or bogus, right? How often do you need to flip the coin? Christoph, you're over here. Twice, right? If you have a coin, head and tail, right? In there, you need to find it out. Can I do it by flipping it once? Traditionally, no. In quantum computing, yes, you can do this, right? You can toss the coin only once, and the quantum computer will tell you whether this is the real coin or a bogus coin. And the algorithm is abstracted, or the problem is abstracted. You have a function, a Boolean function here, and the function is called constant if the head side of the coin is the tail side of the coin, and is balanced if head and coin are different. Right? Is it possible to evaluate f only once to determine whether it's constant or balanced? And this is another secret of quantum computers. You always introduce the controlled operator. If you remember, the value of x determines what the second component is, and this is called in quantum computing an oracle. If you fold the function that you want to evaluate with a controlled operator, then the first qubit, the control qubit, allows you to compute the values of the all different values. I have an example in a second. And this is here, you only, I don't step through it, this is the algorithm of Deutsch that evaluates the oracle of the function f only once. And here, if you measure this result, you have a bogus coin. If you measure this result, you have a real coin. Right? And this can be generalized, right? If you have a function between this register, a Boolean function on this register. I speed up a little bit because it's a miracle happen, right? It's a generalization that happened a couple of years later, right? Then they wanted to find out the minimum number of evaluations of f to find out whether the function is constant or balanced, right? And in the worst case, this is polynomial. In the worst case, you need to run this algorithm polynomial time, right? And then if you apply this Deutsch-Jossa algorithm, you evaluate the function only once. And this is an exponential speedup. It's an exponential speedup of a classical algorithm, right? So, exponential speedup. And this is again quantum parallelism, right? What I have here is this oracle is a unitary map. And if I apply the oracle to this quantum register, what you see is after applying the oracle, you combine each x is combined with its function value. One is combined with the function value f of x. So that means this oracle at the same time manipulates the quantum register, and each value of a qubit is coupled with its function value. It's in a single step because you have inherent quantum parallelism. Single invocation delivers all values, and this is the third secret how all of the quantum algorithms work. So we see a pattern here, right? Or I'm going to hire people to find the pattern in quantum computing, right? Can be obvious exactly. So this is quantum parallelism, as I said before. Single step, single manipulation of the quantum register gives you all the values. Now I speed up a little bit. I have 3 minutes left, and I need 5 minutes. So searching, what is an unstructured search? Unstructured search is you want to find out the based on the phone number to whom the phone number belongs. But phone books are completely different, right? You have the names, and then you look up the phone number of a certain name. If you only know the phone number and want to find out what the name is, you need to search through everything. It's an unstructured search. It basically means the simple solution in the traditional world is O of n, right? And there's a quantum algorithm, the algorithm of Grover, that has the square root of n complexity. The algorithm is extremely complicated. It takes me 2 hours to explain. There is a lot of geometry behind it, right? So you can speed up, it's a quadratic speed up of search. And based on this Grover algorithm, you can speed up many NP problems, right? So what does selective NP problems mean? Selective means you need to find this crazy oracle function that I mentioned before. But there are tons of algorithms in the internet that you can find that have this oracle function. That means many NP problems can be speed up at least quadratically to be solved. For example, traveling salesmen, cracking keys can be solved by this way. And quantum information, just to be fast, no cloning theory means, as a theorem easily to be proved, you cannot copy a quantum bit, right? That means you cannot read it, you cannot copy it, you can only manipulate it and measure it, and then it's gone, right? But what you can do is, if you have a quantum register, then you can copy at most the states that are orthogonal to it. You cannot copy any state, but if you can copy this state, you can copy states that are orthogonal to it. Why is that important? Okay, you can copy orthogonal. Because classical bits are always orthogonal to each other, and classical bits can be copied. That means the world nicely comes together. The traditional world is not in conflict with the quantum world. And there is something, no, I leave that out. Quantum teleportation. Teleportation means, can two parties exchange information about a quantum bit by only exchanging classical bits? I said that a quantum bit is a whole universe, it's a linear combination in a complex vector space, and how can I only transfer two bits, two single bits, so that the other guy knows what the status of my bit was? So the whole joke behind it is again entanglement. So what that means is the two people need to agree, need to create an entangled state. Every person takes one half, one qubit of this entangled state with itself, right? They put it in the pocket, they travel to Crete, and who is, if Kurt Rothärmel measures his bit, right, he impacts immediately my qubit in my pocket, and he only sends information about the bit that he measured, the qubit that he measured, to me, and then I can reconstruct his original status. This is quantum teleportation, because the status got teleported. There is no physical matter teleported, so a spaceship, Starship Enterprise is not possible, right? But your teleportation means you only send a few regular bits, and then you can reconstruct the status of quantum. And lots of algorithms are then also depending on quantum teleportation. Conclusion means hardware of quantum computers is rapidly evolving, and Wilfried will tell you how fast it's currently evolving, what's his things. That means in a few years, deep problems will likely to be solvable. In the lecture, if some of you are interested, I will tell you that you can crack any key in a few minutes. Right? There's a very famous algorithm, the Shor algorithm, that can solve the factorization problem, right? And you can factorize a 1,000 digit number in 48 minutes. With traditional computing, you need 10 to the power of 22, while the universe, the age of the universe is 10 to the power of 13, right? So this is why security is absolutely secret, sure, safe in traditional world, but if we have a quantum computer, and many people believe that we have it fast, traditional security is gone. It's absolutely gone. Blockchain will be gone. Yeah? So quantum computer, you see, strategically, I'm still fighting with you. If the quantum computer is there, you crack any kind of blockchain. So, quantum algorithms is based on postulates of quantum mechanics. That means if you want to dig deeper into it, you need to understand this linear algebra that I only reviewed. And the current state of art is of implementing algorithms is at the assembler level. And people start to think about what is real software, right? How can you build software? What kinds of tools do you need? And the real conclusion is a famous quote by Enrico Fermi, Nobel Prize winner also in physics. He said, "I'm still confused, but at a higher level." I prefer to have a discussion after Winfried.